church and hope everybody's got a cup of coffee and snacks. And we're going to do one called When I Get to Glory. I'm going to sing. Here we go.
Thank you. To trust
772, when we all get to heaven.
Jesus, got it all, big go away. Me and Jesus, got it all, big go away. so it's all over town. We can't afford invented furniture. We can't afford any fancy church. We can't afford any fancy slander. You know, Jesus got a lot for people out doing his work.
Me and Jesus got a lot that goes. Me and Jesus got it all worked out. Me and Jesus got a lot that goes. We don't need anybody to tell us what it's all about. Me and Jesus got a lot that goes. Me and Jesus got it all worked out. Me and Jesus got our own thing going. We don't need anybody to tell us what it's all about. We don't need anybody to tell us what it's all about.
That'll wake everybody up this morning. Thank you.
Precious friend.
Precious memories, how they linger.
Good morning, everybody, and if you're listening to us on the web, like some people do all over the country, good morning to you. It's a sunshiny morning in Oklahoma this morning. Pretty frosty, but it's pretty nice, and we've got a real good, look like 2 weeks of weather headed this way, and hope everybody has a great Thanksgiving this week. I can hardly believe Thanksgiving's already here. Christmas right around the corner, but enjoy the holidays, enjoy your family, and you visitors, we have a Sunday school class at 9, if you want to come to Sunday school, and church starts at 10, and we always have some goodies back here in the back, hot coffee, and some water, and sometimes some juice, and some fruits, and some sweets, and just come back and see us, make yourself at home, and if you want to become a member, get with Pastor Jed, one of us guys, and we'll visit with you about that. We've got some sign-up sheets back on the back table. We're going to have a December 11th holiday meal, and if you're visited, come back that day and eat with us. We always have more than enough, and everybody is welcome that day, but again, I think the church is furnishing the meat. We just need all the goodies that go with it. There's a sign-up sheet back there. We've got a lot of people on our prayer list to just remember all of those, and I was told this morning a friend of ours is in the cow business. He also built some houses over in the Elgin area. We've known his family or his wife's family all my life, and Jerry Pettijohn, we heard, passed away sometime, I believe, yesterday. And Chris Mitchell is his wife. That's some of y'all know Sam Mitchell and Neoma from years past. And anyway, it's their family. Just remember them in your prayers. And we're glad to see Pastor Jed and all of their family back today. They made a whirlwind trip northeast, and I was watching that. I didn't know where y'all went for sure, but 6 foot of snow in Buffalo. I don't know how far that was from you, but anyway, about that far, it's not very far when you're talking 6 feet, but glad y'all made a safe trip, got back, and you may have some more to say about that, but anyway, I don't have anything else today. We're going to stand and salute our flag, and as always, it's in honor of those that have served our country, the ones that serve it now, and the ones that have shed blood and gave the ultimate price for our country and our Constitution. And folks, we are so fortunate. I know things sometimes seem like a mess, but we're so fortunate to live in a country that we live in. And I'm driving out here this morning looking at our countryside and thinking about the song, America the Beautiful, and we live in a beautiful country, and everybody should take pride in it, and it's a privilege that each one of us gives to live in this country and do the things we get to do and come to church and to salute our flag. So at this time, we'll salute the flag.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you would join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father God, thank you. Thank you so much for all these privileges that we get to take, Lord. And just remember these families, Lord, that lost loved ones. Be with Chris and the whole Pettijohn and Mitchell family, Lord, through this time of loss. And God, just give them a helping hand. We just pray that today will be a great day and everybody will have a wonderful Thanksgiving and be so thankful for all the things that we get to do. God, we just pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Visit somebody. Get you a cup of coffee if you hadn't had one. Good evening. See you next week.
Here for the mic tone.
I mean, just leave them run.
Hi, how are you?
It is a little chilly in the morning.
You got something serious wrong up there? That's one speaker supposed to be mine. Right down there. Everything Billy's coming out right there. I can't even hear my stuff. Say he must have switched something up or something. Well, it's not working right. Now that one speaker? Had to do something. I can't even hear myself. All I hear is Billy. It's real loud. With his guitar. Is this not even blending or nothing? Yeah. But his is supposed to. He's got it going in the microphone and then it's going in the back.
All right. Good morning, everybody. It's good to have you all here this morning. We made a quick trip up to Pennsylvania, and I realized why I don't miss snow. Got Dad and Mom back together up there, and had a good service. Melody and Lou were there, and we had a few folk that were just local family folk that were just from that area. On the way home, I stopped at 6 a.m. to get some gas, and it's a good thing we did, because at 6 a.m. on Route 90, they had a 17-car pileup, and we were back out on the road just a mile and a half behind that, but then that left us on the interstate for 9 hours, and so we sat there in the car for 9 hours, and then we had another nine, small car too. That was called close fellowship. So then we traveled another 9 hours to get to our destination that evening. But the funny part is all the electric cars that the tractor trailers just had to shove off the road in our little one-lane path that the tractor trailers made for us when we were free to go, and all the people walking home from all their electric cars, and all the diesel fuel that was used to go with the wreckers to come out and get the electric cars. So, thank you for that. Has anybody gotten arrested yet in Elgin? You haven't gone through Elgin lately?
New speed limit.
Every one of the speed limits have been changed. Every one of them. Not one is the same. And 55 starts way down the road and goes way up the road on the other side. So just be careful. Just saying. I'm just saying. I'm not saying that I got pulled over. I'm not saying that. All right. Anyway, we're having a good time. And praise the Lord that we're back. And it was fun texting some of you because you were wanting a play-by-play every, have you moved yet? No. After about 8 hours of that, they quit texting us. But anyway, they were praying for us, and we appreciate that. This morning, we have the Howells, Jerry and Nancy, are joining the church, and I'm going to ask if they'll just walk up front here with me, and then the board come on up and give them the right hand of fellowship. If we can get the board, I think they went out for more snacks. Yeah. Anyway, we've got a few of them, David and Billy and James, and got a few of them here. You know, I really like Nancy, so that was a shoo-in. But Jerry's kind of official, so I thought, do we really want an official guy in a nutsy church like this? And so I went to tell him no and shook his hand, got a hold of his arm right here, and I said, I'm going to let that guy in. He is pretty strong. All right. Anyway, no, it's a real privilege to have them both here and to hear their testimony. And it's pretty easy to join the church, really. You don't have to join the church. That's, you know, joining the church is just kind of a man-made thing. It's just to say that you want to be a part of the church and that you're dedicated to it, and that's all there is to it. But you read the Constitution, bylaws, to know what we're about, and we don't ask for any quiz or anything on that. And, you know, we just, we don't ask you to sign on a dotted line. We're just asking you to read it so that you know what we're about and that you agree with that. And then we want to hear your testimony. We want to hear, you know, how you came to know Christ and asked him to be your Lord and Savior. And these guys have a very, very clear testimony. It's just fun to meet with them and have them here with us. And so I just want to extend right hand of fellowship to you guys. Congratulations. Yeah. After church, make sure you greet them. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Jerry's former state trooper and part of our protection policy here at the church as well. We have several guys that are involved in that, and so we try to do our best. It's a crazy world we're living in, but we don't want to be ignorant about these things, and so we have some guys that do that, and it's great to have Jerry as part of that team. How many of you have relatives that come for Thanksgiving? You're the smart ones. You told them not to come. They're here right now. That's awesome. It's good to have y'all. You got relatives and people coming? Okay. All right. Well, I have my youngest daughter and her husband and our four littlest grandkids are here this morning. So we doubled the size of Sunday school this morning. And so Megan and Zeke, come on up here. And I'm going to try to use this mic right here. This is... blinking green. Does that mean anything? Testing 1, 2. There it's on. All right. This is Megan and Zeke. Now, the reason why I'm having them introduce themselves is because they actually work in our cowboy church up in northeast Missouri. So they're going to share a little bit about what they do. Just briefly. Go ahead. Yeah, that'd be great.
It says, is that on?
Yeah.
My name is Zeke McGill, and this is Megan. And my oldest, Liam, Matthew, and Abby, and Sadie. And they're all plenty willing to talk to you if you want to have a conversation with varying degrees of comprehensibility there. But yeah, we came home from working overseas as missionaries and came on board with the Cowboy Church up in northeast Missouri. And we mean northeast. Clark County is that corner of Missouri, just by the Iowa line. And we came on board first as the children's pastor and associate pastor, and we got a good group of kids. In the world we live in today, there's a lot of coming and going. Unfortunately, some of the kids are spending every other weekend with that parent, so we don't get them all at the same time. We average about 20 a night. But we have the potential of 40 or 50 a night if they all came at the same time. And our goal has just been to instruct these kids and instill them with the knowledge of God's Word and the mind of God, how God thinks, that they can make good decisions as they're growing, that they can avoid some of the pitfalls that some of us have made. And then along with that, once you start getting several classes, we can't do it all. We started out with the mindset of training some of our other church folks to teach those classes, to teach our teachers, not just in how to prepare a lesson, how to communicate it clearly for various age groups, and how to manage your classroom when they're all as crazy as my kids are, and tools like that, so that if something happened and we were not able to continue, there would be somebody there to keep that kids ministry going. And on top of that, we also help with the different adult ministries, fill in for Pastor Shelby speaking as needed, or we will take turnabout on a particular subject. We just, after finishing up a Sunday night series, we just took our statement of faith for the church. Hey, it's been a little while since we've covered it in this way, kind of topical. So we went through the doctrinal statement of the church, one after the other, and rounded up with the Lord's Supper, and had communion service, and taught on baptism. And then we had a baptismal service, and my two boys got baptized, and two of Pastor Shelby's girls and practiced giving their testimony publicly before the church. And so the Lord's just blessed that. These are crazy times and busy times, and each family, each person who comes has a story, has things going on in their life, both the joys and the pains and the struggles, and just trying to make a living, you know, with prices the way they are. And it's a privilege to be able to minister to them and some hope of God's word and the focus that there's more beyond this life. And there's more beyond just the visible that's going on. So, that's the Lord's really blessing us up there.
Awesome. Get to know Megan and Zeke. They are our kids, and they're here for Thanksgiving this week. And don't pull the string on the back of Matthew's neck there when he starts talking. Okay, so we're going to have a good time with them. So thank you very much. Thank you, guys. Zeke is a child of a best friend of mine that grew up at the ranch, and Zeke, of course, grew up at the ranch too, so he knows a lot about our family and knows a lot about me, so don't ask him any questions. All right. Anyway, just a form of announcement, the Christmas boxes are coming in here that are going into foreign countries to the Franklin Graham Ministry. And this is the last Sunday that you can bring them in here. But if you forgot to bring your box, you can also get it over. I think it's over in Elgin. Is that right? Let's pick up the box at Elgin Baptist, Crossroads Baptist. All right. 9 and 11 Monday morning, or 3:30 to 6 at the Crossroads Baptist. All right, very good. Thank you for that. All right, I think I covered everything. I don't know. Let's see. Speed limits in Elgin. Yeah, okay. All right, take your Bibles and turn to 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58. Now, in the interment of Dad, it was kind of funny. It really wasn't a service. It was just kind of some family and friends from the local area. And so each of us shared just a little bit. And Lou gets up there, and he's gone today. He's out traveling, but he'll be back Monday, I think. But anyway, he gets up, and he cites this portion of Scripture and starts, you know, talking about it. And I'm thinking, he's read my notes. But actually what it was he was teaching about the last part of this, and I'm teaching about the first part of this. And so he was talking about, obviously, in the situation of an interment there with the grave, he's talking about that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And we'll end with that tonight, this morning, but this is not the concentration of what I want us to look at. Today, what I want us to look at is back found in verse 57 of this. This is 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58, just two verses. As we think about Thanksgiving, and so I have strayed from the series that I'm in right now, the prophecies concerning Jesus Christ, and over 100 prophecies that were mentioned thousands of years, hundreds of years before Christ was even born or brought into this world. Just fascinating study. So we're going to take a break from that study and just look at Thanksgiving this morning. And this is not a portion necessarily that's used as Thanksgiving messengers. There's a lot of parts in the Scripture that tells us to be thankful and those kinds of things, but this one gives us reasons, I think. And what I've done is I've broken these two verses down into, first of all, just a natural reaction that we have to give thanks, but then a study on it gives us a reflection about these things, and then what's our exertion from that? What's the energy that comes out of that? And so that's what I want us to look at this morning. So right here in 1 Corinthians 15, if you all have that, verse 57 and 58 says, "But thanks be to God," and that's where I got the title, "thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." And as I read these two verses, I saw this just a natural reaction to give thanks. You know, giving thanks to God is just a natural reaction. And he gives us two reasons. One is multitude implications to that, but one is very specific. And so these two reasons, one is salvation, very specific. Verse 56, going back a ways, just one verse, and verse 55 talks about salvation. It doesn't mention that right there, but it mentions the results of our salvation, that we see that death, where is your sting? And Hades, where is your victory? And the sting of death is sin, but it's been swallowed up because the law no longer has strength for those that are in Christ. When once you're in Christ, there's no longer the penalty of sin placed upon us. All of our sins in the past have been forgiven, all of our sins in the present, and all of our sins in the future. All we have to do is just simply confess that what we have done is wrong, and God says, "I forgive you." And we need to come before the Lord and accept this salvation, and that's what he's talking about here in verse 57. Thanks be to God for the gifts that are given. So these are the obvious things here, salvation, and then everyday life. You know, the privilege of everyday life. We observe people, and we were getting up in the morning at our hotel, and we'd gone down for breakfast, and there was a family there of some really good-looking young men and a dad, and they were traveling through, and they went and they got their breakfast, you know, and the dad was just kind of unresponsive, and there was, I just noticed that they didn't give any thanks for their breakfast, you know, and a lot of people don't. You've seen that in restaurants and whatever. And when somebody does, you kind of take note of that. You know, it's kind of really different. And it's kind of funny because I'm thinking, you know, you don't recognize that this is a privilege. This is a gift. Now, those of us that have traveled in foreign countries and where these boxes are going, these people have nothing. I mean, they have absolutely nothing. And if they get something to eat, that week, they're really grateful. They're really grateful. And to see the gratefulness in a third world country, and we come to the United States, we just take everything for granted. When I come back from a third world country, one of the first things I do is get a drink of water. I get a drink of water, and I thank the government for all of its rules and regulations that when I put my lips on that thing, it's going to be pure, you know, chlorinated, yeah, but it's going to be water that I can drink. And we have so many privileges in this country, and we don't like the regulations, and I don't like them either. I mean, I've worked for, my family has worked over 60 years in camp ministries, and you talk about regulations. You haven't seen regulations until you try to do camp work. And so we have government camp work, and you get really tired of it. But you go to a third world country, you come home to America, and you're going, "God bless America." And that's just the way it is. And, you know, here's a family. And I'm thinking, you know, okay, so here's a dad maybe that you know, he's done it all himself, right? I mean, that's what you do. If you're not thankful, you do it all yourself, right? Did you know that? Yeah, and that's why we aren't thankful, because we've done it all ourselves. And you don't even consider the fact that you're breathing is a gift from God. The fact that you're breathing, the fact that you had a job so that you could afford to bring your kids to that hotel, that's a gift of God. Amen. The fact that you live in America and not grown up in a third world country where you don't have anything to eat, that's a gift from God. You had no choice of where you were going to be born. And so, you know, we have these things that are just natural, and those of us that are thankful understand that these things that are just natural in our life, we can be grateful for that. And so we are thankful. Thanks be to God for his provisions for our lives daily. And then it says here in this verse, verse 57, it says, "For the victory that is given." And so we become thankful for that. For what victory are we talking about? Well, you can go back to 55 and 56, the victory over death, right? The victory over the sting of that death. You know, when I laid my dad's ashes in the grave the other day, I didn't think it was going to affect me that much. until you get that little final moment, you know, where he's going down on the ground. Lou and I lowered this little coffin, and you know, we're enjoying the fellowship with our friends and stuff, and we sang a few songs, said a few words, and so it was time. We're just going to go put that in there, you know. It's just a little box, and when it went down that hole, just this flood of emotion just hit me. And yet, I still understood the grace of God, given the fact that I get to see my dad again someday. And at my age, it's closer now than I ever was. But anyway, you know, you have this emotion, but you don't have the sting. You don't have the hopelessness when you're in the Lord, because you know it still hurts, but you have hope, right? You have hope of seeing them again someday. A lot of people say that, but they're just saying empty words because they have no knowledge of the fact of salvation, meeting an awesome, holy God someday, and having to deal with that God, and that as a Christian, we are sinners, but saved by grace, and we can meet that God with hope and peace. So we're thankful. Thankful for that victory over death. Acts 1:8 says that the Holy Spirit will be given unto you, and you'll receive power. And that's power to have victory. It's not just power to show signs and wonders what they were doing. It was power to have power over this sin in our life, victory over temptation in our life, power to be able to witness to somebody. How many of you are scared to death to share Christ with somebody or give your testimony to somebody? I think all of us have a little intimidation by that. Why? We shouldn't, because the Holy Spirit has given us power to be able to witness to that person. And I find that every time that I trust Him and I make a little statement to somebody, or I pray with somebody. I prayed with somebody yesterday. They were hurting. And, you know, it was just a person selling me stuff, selling me food. But they were hurting, and they started telling me their whole life story. And I'm sitting there. They didn't know me from Adam. And I said, you know what? We just need to pray about this. And so I shared with them a little bit, and we prayed. And they appreciated it. You can do that over top of your, you know, shyness because of the power of the Holy Spirit. And we have that. That's victory. That's what that's called. And victory over temptation to sin. And so we're thankful for that. So then you think about that. You think about that and you get a little bit of a reflection. Why should I be so thankful for all those things? And you go back and you look at this same verse. Did you notice this? It says in verse 57, it says, but thanks be to God who gives. Did you see that? Who gave is one thing. And we would understand it if the verse said that, right? This is Paul writing long after the death of Christ. Thanks be to God who gave. We would get that, wouldn't we? Gave Jesus. What does the word give say to you? Gives, plural. That says it's a continuation. In fact, in the original Greek, that's what it's saying. Who continues to give, and he gives, and he gives. It is just a natural characteristic of God to be a giving and providing God. Have you seen God that way? You know, we have so many what we think are needs, you know, until you go to a third world country. But we have all these self-centered needs and stuff, and we want God to give me, give me, give me. And we want to try to put a bowl full of jelly on his belly and give him a white beard and call him Santa Claus. But actually, the truth is, it isn't God's nature to be giving. And he gives us, and he gives us, and he gives us. We're just not grateful for it. And if you start to ponder on that kind of thanksgiving, you begin to realize, wow, this is very true. He gives. He gives. That's the kind of God he really is. And that's his character. That's what he wants to do. In the Greek, it's in that present participle, which means it's continual. And then we see that he is not only giving, but he's victorious. That's what he says here. He says, thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. He is victorious. Over what? Over everything. Over everything he's victorious. You know, this is the kind of God that we begin to reflect on. It's a continual gift there as well, so it's continual victory. There are some verses in the Bible that just stand out to me, like John 16:33 says, in this world you're going to have tribulation. Do you believe that? How many of you get out of this world with no tribulation at all? I don't think so. You know, you're going to have tribulation in this world, right? I mean, just about the time you think everything's going well, the car breaks down. Isn't that true? Yeah. And so you buy a Chevy. All right. So anyway, then you have these problems in your, what? So you have these problems in your life, you know, that are constant. You know, your neighbor's problems, your, you know, the school's problems, the, you know, your children's problems, your spouse problems. You have all these problems, but listen, when you ponder on the victory, the continual victory that God will give to you, if you turn these things over to Him, you start to be thankful. You just start being thankful because it's a continual gift of God's grace and His ability. Man, if you don't think God can handle your problem, your God is just way too small. Yeah, you need to get a new one. Yeah. So this new improved image is God Almighty. And so we have Matthew 16. He says, anyway, in John 16, he says, be of good cheer because I have overcome. I have overcome the world. And then we see in Matthew 16, he tells Peter, he says, listen, he says, the church is a moving force. See, if you're sitting still as a church, that is not what God intends ever. The church is a moving force and the gates of hell. Stationary. Do you see that in that scripture? The stationary gates of hell will not be able to prevail against the moving church. That's victory. That's continual victory. You know, gates of hell. Whatever Satan stands, puts in the place to block the church's moving force, the gates of hell cannot withstand it. It has to move. That's a promise from God. That's much reality as the law of gravity. So much as reality as the law of gravity is that gravity that you cannot jump up without coming back down. Satan cannot block the efforts of a moving church. That's just the way it is. And so why? Then there's a third thing that we begin to reflect on. He says here, he says, therefore, because of this, that's the word therefore means, because of the previous verse, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding. And so that's what he's saying here, to stand first, be firm, be steadfast. Now, if you just scroll down a little bit, or like us old people do, turn the page, all right, to chapter 16, and look at one verse there, verse 13 of chapter 16. It's just the next page. Verse 13 says, watch, stand fast in the faith, be brave, be strong. Wow, that's pretty powerful, isn't it? Watch and stand fast. Why should we stand fast? Well, chapter 15 is all about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about. And these are the last verses of chapter 15. So Paul is basically saying, therefore, because of this power of Christ, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you can stand fast. Don't be movable. Don't be wishy-washy. Stand up for what is right. Do the right thing. And that's what he says. Joshua 1:9. Do you remember that verse? You ever read the book of Joshua? This is right at the beginning of Joshua. This guy trembling in his cowboy boots. Well, in his sandals. He's trembling in his sandals. He's going to go into the promised land. You know, Moses is up on a hill somewhere. Nobody even knows where he's at. He's been dead and buried. God buried him so that nobody can find his body. And everybody's staring at Joshua now. You're it. And Joshua is kind of a reluctant leader. And God has to encourage him. And he says to him in chapter 1, verse 9, he says, have not I commanded you? And this is what he says. This is what he reminds Joshua of. He says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Don't be afraid or dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you put your foot down, wherever you go. Do you believe that? No, the Lord God is only with me as long as I'm in Cattle County or as long as I'm in Comanche County. If I get outside of that, good Lord. You know, I might be stuck 9 hours in traffic. Do you know what Deb and I were thinking in that 9 hours in traffic? Do you know what we were thinking? Where's the bathroom? And how do we open two doors of a car and pee on the ground in front of this tractor trailer that's staring down at us? You know? Well, besides that, we were also thinking God is with us. He's already saved us from a 17-car pileup. You know, He's already said He had us get off the road. He just had us get off the road. He's protected us. And here we are sitting right here. You know, and then we were calling out to God as soon as we got in the traffic at Oklahoma City. But other than that, we had a great trip. So we have this this God who is with us no matter where we go. Can you stand fast because of that? Yeah. Yeah. Stand fast. You don't run. You don't turn your back. You can stand fast because we have this God. Well, then there's this exertion that comes out of it. You're sitting there and you're thanking God, right? And at Thanksgiving time, you should be able to go around the table and think of things that you can thank God for, right? Don't just say thank for. You thank God. Tell the Lord about it. Thank God for that. But as you do that, I want you to reflect. Reflect on that and think about God. And that's what this is in verse 58. But then there should be some exertion that comes out of you because of that. I think I'm going to do this. And this is what he says. Get back a page. And this is what he says in the last verse there. He says, be steadfast, immovable. And then he says, always. How long is always? Yeah, it's pretty long, isn't it? How long is always? He says, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Being a tigger. Yeah. The little abounding, hoppy little tigger guy, you know, there in Winnie the Pooh. Always abounding. Be a tigger when it comes to the work of the Lord. And that's what he's saying. Abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And so this exertion of giving thanks to God to always abound for Christ's sake, Ephesians 2:20. We are created intentionally to do good works for God. Not for our salvation, but once we are saved, he has purpose for our life. And to do, I go to the hospital, I don't know how many times a year, sometimes a lot of times a month. And sometimes there's some good, dear old soul there that says these words, and sometimes they mean it, sometimes they're just words. They say things like this, well, I guess God's not done with me yet. He's got some, and then they say this. Starts with a P. You know what I'm going to say? He's got some purpose for my life. Now, some people come out of the hospital and they start looking for that purpose. And some people come out of the hospital and they're the same unchanged person that they've always been. They don't mean a thing by that. Does God have purpose for your life? Yes. Every one of you here is made uniquely different. Isn't that great? Yeah. Every one of you here is made uniquely different. God intended it to be that way because he intended to build you for purpose. For purpose. Yeah. So we all have different purposes that we were made for, and we were created for these things. Are you abounding in that purpose? Do you even know what it is? Personally, what about spiritual maturity and spiritual growth? Do you have a purpose to grow this year spiritually? Huh? Or are you going to be same old that you've ever been for the last 20 years? You know, do you have a purpose in that? Your thankfulness to God for what he has done for you should have given you some exertion to do that. And then for the ministry, making advancements for the kingdom. What are we going to do this year to make advancements for the kingdom? Are you excited about that? I mean, we've done a lot in the last couple of years here since Dad was here. And there's been purpose, right? Purpose. We've done a lot. In the passing of Deb, we've done a lot. The board members have shoved on forward. The mission committee has shoved on forward. Everybody is shoving on forward. Ladies ministry, children's work is shoving on forward. That's the way it should be. When you stay same and stay sterile in your Christian walk, that's wrong. And when the church stays sterile, that also is wrong. Yeah. You know, we've got a gossip column out there talking about the Cowboy Church in Apache here. Did you know that? There are people saying, what is going on there? Well, it's God. That's all it is. And God is encouraging his people to move forward, and you're being obedient. When we say no, that's when it'll all quit. I'll tell you that right now. It'll all quit when we say no. I'm not saying to be stupid or crazy. Just simply do what God is asking you to do, and there's purpose in ministry. Always abounding. Always be encouraged in the labor of Christ, he says, because your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And let me conclude with a little verse there at the bottom, Galatians 6:9. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we will reap if we faint not. Happy Thanksgiving. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that we can go to it anytime we want to and hear from you. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that empowers us and gives us strength to have victory. Thank you for your multitudes of gifts and the fact that you just didn't give. You give. Thank you for your son. Thank you for sorrow that's different than the world's. And to this end, we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning. God bless you.